Hi, I'm Jenny Brockie. Tonight on Insight, how sick can you get from a tick? You were bitten by a tick, and what happened after that?
I said, I can't see, and I just went down. That was it.
What did you have?
Lyme disease. Yeah, I got really ill at Wimbledon earlier in the year.
Would you prefer a wrong diagnosis to no diagnosis?
The people that are sick need the action. They don't need the words.
But first, we must do no harm.
Welcome, everybody. Good to have you here. Vivian, you were bitten by a tick while you were bushwalking on the south coast last year. What happened after that?
Well, my friend Julie got the whole tick out, and we were very pleased with that because we thought, great, we've got the head out, fine.
And what happened after that?
About 3 minutes after that, I felt very warm, and I said, I don't feel so good. And I said, I can't see. And I just went down. That was it.
Julie, what happened at the time?
All of a sudden she just did a huge vomit and then went unconscious. We popped her on her side and rang Triple O straight away. And the ambulance came within 5 or 10 minutes, which was fabulous.
How sick was she?
Jackie, my friend, couldn't feel a pulse. We were pretty worried, actually.
How long did it take for you to recover from that?
Well, the ambulance came and they put quite a lot of adrenaline into me. So, and then I went to hospital overnight with a steroid drip. But after that, I was fine.
And what did they tell you had happened? What did they tell you?
They said that I'd had an extreme anaphylactic reaction
to the tick bite.
Yeah, because there were no hives, no rash, no shortness of breath, no throat swelling, nothing. And I'd had ticks before, plenty of times in my life, with no particular reaction.
Mm. How do you feel about ticks now?
Because my anaphylaxis is so extreme, even a tiny baby tick will have a very serious and possibly fatal effect. So now I can't... I'm concerned about living on the east coast of Australia where the paralysis tick is endemic. So that's meant that I've left my house, my family and my friends, and I'm searching for somewhere that's safe for me to live.
And where might that be?
I think the band of 30 kilometres down the east coast of Australia and large parts of Victoria have that particular tick, and so anywhere that's not there.
Were you given an explanation as to why you could have been bitten by ticks before and not had a reaction, but this time you did?
I think, to me, it's quite random. It's a mysterious thing. Ticks are very strange and mysterious creatures, yeah.
Ella, you're 16. You had an anaphylactic reaction at a Halloween party last year. What caused the reaction?
Well, earlier that night I'd gotten ready with my friends at a friend's house and we'd had some food before while we were getting ready and I had 4 chips and her mum had turned steak beforehand and accidentally turned the chips with the same tongs. And 3 hours later at the party, my lips were kind of swollen and I went into the bathroom and just looked in the mirror. I'm like, oh gosh, I'm having an anaphylactic reaction.
Had you had that before?
I'd had a mild one earlier.
To meat?
To meat, yes. Because it used to be just hives. But gradually it got worse and I became more sensitive.
So what happened to you this night? Did you have an EpiPen to use?
Yeah, I had an EpiPen with me.
Did you use it?
No.
Why didn't you use it?
I don't know. I guess I kind of thought that I was going to be all right and that I'd make it to the hospital in time. And I didn't really... I hate needles. Needles terrify me. So it was kind of also the fact of using a needle wasn't very appealing to me, I guess, but, yeah.
What other foods and products are you allergic to apart from red meat. Is it red meat or all meat?
It's red meat and pork. Red meat. Yeah. Mm. But I'm also allergic to all mammal products. So that means that I can't have dairy products, goat milk, cheese milk. But I think having the allergy, it's frustrating and it's hard.
Shelley, you're Ella's mum. How long has she had these allergies?
Around the age of 3 to 4, I knew that there were significant problems, and we went from doctor to doctor to specialist, and the most hopeful advice we got at that age was to keep a food diary. But the reaction seemed so random. So on one day it might be to pork, on another day it might be to ice cream, and so on and so on and so on. And then we ended up seeing a wonderful GP in Manly that suggested that her anaphylaxis trip to hospital perhaps might have that link with the red meat allergy that had been recently discovered and written about in journals by the professor. So he recommended that we go and see her.
And what were you told caused that red meat allergy?
Tick bites. So she went to a preschool in Terry Hills on the Northern Beaches, and she used to get bitten by ticks there a lot. And the last day she spent there, I stopped counting at 60. So significant, significant tick issues.
Mm-hmm. And so a direct link was drawn?
No, not immediately. It took a long time before, tens of thousands of dollars and visits.
Mm-hmm. Cheryl, you're a clinical immunologist and an allergist. Is there a name for Ella's allergy?
Well, there are about over 1,000 people in the northern part of Sydney who suffer from mammalian meat allergy after tick bite.
Now, you discovered this connection, is that right?
That's correct.
How did you discover that connection?
One of the tricky parts of mammalian meat allergy is that it's 2 to 10 hours after people consume the meat. And so the connection had been difficult for people to make, but it started becoming more common after around 2003. And I'd seen probably in excess of 50 people then, and it impressed me that everybody had been bitten by a tick who had this.
So this obviously doesn't happen to everybody who gets bit by a tick, but how soon after people are bitten by ticks does this allergy show up?
Usually it takes around a month. Sometimes it's much longer.
Craig, you've been a gardener around the northern beaches of Sydney for 27 years. Now, that's an area notorious for ticks. When were you last bitten by a tick?
I was bitten probably a couple of weeks ago. I usually find them crawling on me at first because I'm quite sensitive to them. I mean, I've been bitten over those 27 years, even as a child, I think, but
probably about... How many times would you have been bitten, do you think?
Oh, it's hard to say because you might get a paralysis tick, which is quite large and singular on you, whereas you might walk through a swathe of grass ticks, which are the nymph developmental stage of the, you know, the paralysis tick. So you might have 40 or 50 crawling on your legs, which I've had before.
Do you get sick?
I've been sick a few times. I've had tick typhus a couple of times. The first time was quite acute and had really bad sort of fevers and cold sweats, headaches, sensitive to light. And the only thing that sort of drew me to it was it didn't go, it was just persistent. And I thought, oh, this is the worst, you know, flu I've ever had. So I just went down to the GP and he said, well, let's get you onto the antibiotic, which was doxycycline, which is an anti-malarial. And
how long did you take that for?
10 days, the course is.
Mm-hmm. And afterwards?
Fine.
Miles, you're an infectious disease specialist. What illnesses do we know tick bites can cause in Australia?
Well, on the East Coast, the commonest one is what we used to call Queensland tick typhus, but is now generally called Australian spotted fever because we have subsequently recognised cases Sydney, Victoria. There's also a new rickettsia, which the chap sitting next to me was involved in the discovery of, called Flinders Island spotted fever, which is also a spotted fever group, rickettsia. And there are
what's a rickettsia?
Rickettsia are tick-transmitted organisms.
Right, so there are a number of illnesses we know, and everyone agrees, are caused by ticks.
That's correct. And, yeah. and we also know that ticks are full of lots of other organisms. What we don't know is whether they cause disease in humans, so that link hasn't been made.
Mm. And when we talk about ticks, how many different types of ticks are they, and can they all cause these problems?
Well, there are dozens of ticks in Australia, many of them imported and not native to Australia, but very few of them actually bite humans.
All right. Cheryl, I think at this point everyone is going to want to know, what do you do if you find a tick lodged on your body?
So the first thing is, if you live in a tick endemic area, don't scratch anything you can't see because it could be a tick. If you have a tick, don't disturb the tick.
Why?
Because she will squirt allergen into you at that point.
You are
she is trying to make her 2,500 to 3,000 babies, and you are getting in the way if you disturb her.
So don't grab the tweezers.
Don't disturb the tick. Don't use anything that's going to compress the tick. Basically, kill the tick where it is.
How?
So if it's a small tick, a larval tick or a nymph stage tick, use Lyclear. So just drop the cream onto the top. Don't rub it in.
Use what?
Lyclear, it's a cream used for scabies.
If you haven't got your Lyclear, what can you do?
Leave the tick alone.
So go to the hospital or go to the doctor?
That's right, that's right. So attend your general practice or go to the emergency department.
And then if you've put the Lyclear on the tick, what do you do then?
Leave it for 1 to 3 hours. The tick will then be dead, and then you can safely scrape it off, say shave it or whatever. So with an adult tick, what we like you to do is to get about 0.5 centimetre above and hit it with a freezing agent, because that kills it instantly and she can't squirt then. Whatever you do, don't use household tweezers. They're too thick.
What is a freezing agent?
Freezing agents are ether containing. They're used for skin tags and for wart removal. But if you do have a tick, then don't touch it. Kill it. Don't squeeze it. And it all should be well.
Sam Stosur, you're Australia's top women's tennis player, but you became very ill in 2007 and your game suffered as a result. Let's have a look.
Stosur breaking in the very first game to take a 3-1 lead and then falling in a heap. The 29th seed, who has been sidelined for almost 2 months with the measles, collapsing in straight sets 6-3, 6-2.
So with unforced error number 30...
You didn't have measles. What did you have?
No. Lyme disease, but I didn't know at that point. So, I got really ill at Wimbledon earlier in the year, so in June, and thought I could go back to the States and play. And as it turns out, I could. I knew I wasn't going to win that match after about 3 games.
Mm. Now, Lyme disease is caused by tick bites.
Yep.
How long did it take for you to get the right diagnosis? You were overseas at the time.
So I went over there, played... And by the end of that week, I ended up with meningitis and in hospital, and then I ended up staying in the States for another couple of months until they diagnosed me, with Lyme.
Mm. And why was it so hard to get the diagnosis?
I think because, I was in 3 different continents. So I started in England, in the UK, and then came back to Australia, and it's not recognised here, so that was never even on the radar. And... as it turns out, it was a very good decision to go back to America and try and play. And
where do you think you got it?
I think I got it in Paris. I don't know, but you can get bitten and not feel anything for up to 10 months. So I'm kind of guessing at that.
And in the end, you know, once it was diagnosed in America, was there any doubt about what it was?
No, the infectious disease specialist that I went and saw, once he put all my symptoms together, what I'd felt, how long, once I had the meningitis, that was all kind of... And then all the tests, blood tests and everything that I had done, once he put all that together, he was pretty adamant that I definitely had Lyme and that's what he was going to treat me for.
So the test results came back showing positive to Lyme disease?
There's no test to say you've actually got Lyme, but putting whatever all these other things are together and all my symptoms, that's what he'd come up with.
Mm. And were you training during all this period? Were you still trying to play?
Yeah, well, I played in New York and I just started with my coach, actually. So he's like, hey, you just got to get fit, got to get you back. And so that's what we were doing. And then I got really sick one night and had lots of chest pains and went to hospital. They couldn't tell me what was wrong. And then a few days later, I flew back to where I based myself in Florida and had this pounding headache. And the first hospital I went to told me I had sinusitis, which I was convinced I did not have. But went home and about 24 hours later went back to hospital and they did a spinal tap, and that's where they said that I had viral meningitis. And then from there, then we could kind of... Once I was over that, then that's when I started to see the specialist.
Mm. Miles, what is Lyme disease?
Well, Lyme disease is a infection by a Borrelia burgdorferi group, and the transmission is by a tick bite. And this is endemic in North America, Europe, Asia, and probably cases down as far as Thailand, but that's as far as it's been proven to extend.
And what are the symptoms?
The symptoms are in several stages, depending on when you're diagnosed, but it's generally broken down into early and late Lyme disease. And if the diagnosis isn't made at that stage, the bug can spread to other organs, including the lining of the brain, meninges, the heart, the nerves, particularly in the head region, cranial neuritis, we call it, and then to joints. And it can even infect the brain itself, which is called encephalitis, and that's the hardest to treat form of Lyme disease.
Have you ever diagnosed someone in Australia with Lyme disease acquired here?
Not acquired here, no. I've diagnosed a number of cases acquired overseas.
So do you think Lyme disease exists here?
Well, I don't have to think, because medicine actually operates on scientific principles. So the question is, what is the data? And as I say, multiple investigators have looked into this question, looking for the organism in ticks, what we call reservoir animals and human beings, and there's been no definitive proof of them in Australia. In all the other countries that we've discussed, it's very easy to find the organism. So if you have endemic Lyme disease, you can find the organism anywhere you look, in the ticks, in the animals, or the human beings.
But not here?
Not here.
The people that are sick need the action. They don't need the words.
But first we must do no harm.
Excellent. Great. So if I die on your watch, is that doing no harm?
Jesse, you were on a beach on the Central Coast a couple of years ago when something unusual happened. What happened?
Absolutely. I was on the Central Coast. We were just hanging out with the family. We'd walk past a marsh and some bushland and stuff to get to some sand dunes. And my wife actually went back to the car because she didn't enjoy the bugs that were present. There was sand flies and there was little bugs crawling on our feet and stuff like that. And we just sort of shook it off, had a bit of a play, and then we went back to the cars and stuff like that.
And did you notice anything had bitten you or...?
Not at the time. They were very small and they were creepy crawly. We just brushed them off and went on our merry way.
And what happened about a week after that?
So I took a flight to New Zealand, and as soon as I got to New Zealand, I was starting to get sick. I got very, very ill, spent most of my 10 days in the bottom of the shower, fevers, chills, fatigue, all sorts of things like that. I went and saw New Zealand doctors. I got tested for all sorts of things and they couldn't find anything that was causing the issue, and yet I was just chronically sick. It was nasty.
How long did those symptoms last?
So they started subsiding after about 10 days. And then when I got back to Australia, like, I could never really actually shake it. I started having even more and more symptoms that would start accumulating. I'd start having headaches. I'd have fatigue. I'd have muscle aches, pains, to the point where I could barely get out of bed. I was also, like, having stomach and digestion problems, chronic diarrhea, all sorts of things that were just... Not normal, and I started seeing doctors.
How many doctors?
I saw somewhere between 16 and 19 doctors that just kept telling me there's nothing wrong with you, or you need to take probiotics, or, you know, your immune system's just low at the moment, or you need to see a psychiatrist was the last one that I started getting quite upset with him. And yeah.
How long had it been going on at this point?
So I saw doctors for about 9 months.
What did you do eventually?
So eventually I was told by one doctor, oh, I think you need to, go and see a chronic fatigue specialist. And then the chronic fatigue doctor said, I don't think you've got chronic fatigue. I think you've got a Lyme-like illness.
A Lyme-like illness or Lyme disease?
He said a Lyme-like illness.
Chanel, you're 17. When were you told by a GP here in Australia that you had Lyme disease?
Was it a year or two ago?
Yeah, it was 2013.
And what were your symptoms?
I was fatigued, lots of headaches, stomach pains, muscle pain.
And how long had that been going on?
About 5 years.
5 years you'd had those symptoms. And had you been to many doctors about them? Kate, you're Chanel's mum. When did the idea of Lyme disease come into the picture here with Chanel?
Yeah, well, it was about 6 years after she first started getting her symptoms. We were fishing around for about 3 years trying to get a diagnosis with no luck on the Sunshine Coast. And we weren't getting anywhere with that. So we went to see a holistic GP in Sydney.
So when did Lyme disease get raised?
He did ask if she had ever been bitten by a tick. So I guess at that stage he probably had an idea that maybe that could have been a reason why.
So when the doctor said that he thought she had Lyme disease, this was before any testing or anything like that?
Yeah, it was a clinical examination. Mm. And he just suspected it.
What did doctors say to you? Because a lot of doctors didn't believe you, did they?
No, they don't. No. I guess with so many different symptoms, they would just sort of come to the conclusion that she was making it up. Or that I was making it up. Or we were both making it up because we wanted to, you know. No one wants this. No one wants to be sick with this. It's debilitating and it's horrible. So I wouldn't wish it on anyone. So why they think we're making it up, I have no idea.
Why are you so convinced, though, that she has Lyme disease and not something else when the science is saying Lyme disease doesn't exist here?
Yeah. We had been everywhere. We had been to every specialist. So when we finally got a diagnosis, it was a sort of a relief to think that we could start treating her.
Can I get a reaction from some of the doctors here?
Yeah, laboratory bench.
Well, it's very interesting to hear that, and I'm sorry your daughter's been sick for so long, but it's probably not Lyme disease, to be quite honest, unless she's travelled overseas to a Lyme endemic area.
Call it what really you want. It's a bacteria that's in her system. We don't call it Lyme. Mm.
Well, there are things in ticks that can make people sick, and certainly rickettsial diseases, which we've discussed earlier, they can have a long post-infectious sequelae involving fatigue and strange symptoms of pain, headache, muscle pains and things like that. So that is recognised. But there may in fact be other illnesses that have not yet been diagnosed that are associated with ticks. But we're saying you almost certainly haven't got Lyme disease, because all the studies that have been done, there have now been four large studies done over the last 20 years looking at many, many ticks in Australia, thousands of ticks, and none of them have found Lyme disease bacteria in the ticks.
You've had doctors tell you you've got Lyme disease, right?
I've had doctors tell me that I have a Lyme-like disease, and I agree completely. I think that there is a disease that is out there that is Lyme-like. It has similar symptoms to Lyme. It has similar features to Lyme, and I think some of the co-infections are probably there as well.
Okay, so there's agreement then, because this is a ferocious debate around Lyme disease.
Using the term Lyme-like actually has inhibited the studies, because it's made people focus on looking for this organism which we know is not present in Australia. There may be other organisms, but we haven't been looking at them because everybody is talking about Lyme-like or Lyme disease. Mm. It's taking us down a sidetrack.
Why are people, if as you say, the science is you know, suggesting that the Lyme disease that we're seeing in the rest of the world doesn't exist here, why are people in Australia being told by Australian GPs they have Lyme disease?
Well, firstly, they're not specialists in infectious diseases, so they're extrapolating from an overseas experience and assuming it's the same thing. And there's a whole series of deductions which haven't been proven along the way. So that's why we have to address this with an open mind. Yes, there's illness in the community. We don't know much about it. We need to study it in a scientific manner.
Can I get a reaction from you?
Can I just say, I think it's the scientist's job to start with to do that. And as a mother of a very sick child for a very long amount of time, I just want someone to make her better.
Yep, Jessie.
I don't think anybody really cares what we call it. Like, you can call it whatever you want, but you need to study it and you need to hurry up about it.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, my dog has technology to actually protect from ticks, but I don't.
Okay, Gail, you're a GP on the New South Wales Mid-North Coast. You've been associated with diagnosing Australians with Lyme disease on the basis of tick bites here. Do you think it exists in Australia?
No, I don't think Lyme disease exists in Australia for the reasons that Miles mentions. But I have... I see a lot of people with similar stories to the stories we're hearing now, and there are many people who have got illnesses that are comparable to what is known in the United States anyway as chronic Lyme disease by some, but have just slightly taking issue with what Miles said about everybody knowing what Lyme disease is. In the States, there's a kind of two camps. There is chronic Lyme disease, there's not chronic Lyme disease. But the sort of stories that we're talking about of people having been sick for, well, months to years, perhaps even a decade or longer, and doctors who work like me, we often see diseases that don't have a conventional medical diagnosis and are often quite complicated. And what the way that I got into, inverted commas, Lyme or Lyme-like disease was trying to tease out what's going on for these people. And someone actually came to me and said they'd been diagnosed with Lyme disease.
So what do you think then of doctors diagnosing people with Lyme disease in Australia?
Well, I think it's really, it's kind of a, it's a misnomer. As Miles said, I agree. I don't think we should use that term. We know there are things, there are organisms that get into us that sometimes make us sick right at the beginning, and that's really relatively easy to pick up. But there are also, we know there are other organisms that get into us that cause infections over the long term. And if we in Australia as health professionals use the term Lyme disease, then there are others reasonably would say, no, it's not Lyme disease, it can't be, because there isn't Lyme disease in Australia. And it diverts attention from the sick person. Right. That's the big problem.
Mm. Yes, Stephen.
Yes, look, Gail's correct. There are a lot of infections that after the patient has an acute illness and thinks they've got over it, it actually drags on. And we see it in lots of illnesses. So it's quite a common phenomenon, and it's not related specifically to any one type of infection. It's to do with the patient's immune system. It's probably their immune system reacting in an aberrant way to the type of infection, whatever that infection was, that they got from the tick bite.
Mm. How did your doctor confirm your diagnosis, Jesse?
So I had a test done through Igenix in America after my mum convinced me to do it, because I was cash strapped after battling this whatever I had for nine or 12 months by that time.
How much did the test cost?
It was $2,500.
And what did the test show?
So it showed that I was actually shocked by it. It said it was positive for something called Babesia, for another one called HME, and then Duncani as well.
And what did that mean? What did that effectively mean in terms of what you had?
It effectively meant I had three active co-infections.
And they were Lyme related?
They're Lyme related. They're co-infections to Lyme disease. Hmm.
So was the conclusion that your doctor reached that you had Lyme disease?
Well, he said Lyme-like illness, and we're treating it as a Lyme-like illness, and the
so that means treating it like Lyme disease?
Yes, I would say, yeah.
Do you want me to clarify that? I'm in a position to do so, having worked in that area a bit. So
the, well, you can't clarify his case.
No, but those sort of results. So those three things that were positive on the test results were three different infectious organisms, or two, because it might be Babesia duncani, which is one organism. And then it's not that they're Lyme, they're not related to Lyme. They're also organisms that can be carried by ticks, and then and they can also cause disease in human beings, and they can be tested for, and Igenix does some testing for it, and then it's up to the doctor to make an interpretation of those results and the symptoms of the patient and decide, is there a match? And then, based on the clinical decision and the patient's preference, work out a treatment plan.
Okay. Chanel, where were you tested? How were you tested?
I think it was the same.
Yeah. Her first blood tests were sent to Australian Biologics in Sydney, and they came back with a positive for borreliosis.
Which is?
Which is the bacteria that is found in similar Lyme-like disease. And also her bloods were also sent to Igenix as well.
Mm. And how much did that cost?
All up, over $3,000, $4,000.
Stephen, what do you think of these tests?
Well, most of the tests are looking for antibodies in the patient's blood. Antibodies that have been stimulated by the patient's immune system. So we've all got antibodies in our blood to all the microbes we've been exposed to in the last 6 months or so. Now, just because I suddenly feel unwell and he suddenly finds an antibody to something in my blood, it doesn't mean they're connected.
So you're saying you can't draw firm conclusions from those tests?
Yeah. If you want to do it properly, looking at antibodies, you've got to show a negative to positive change over time, and that's called a seroconversion, or you've got to show a change in antibody level from low to high over a period of days or weeks. And they are the only two ways you can be sure that an antibody test is connected with the patient's illness. Mm. Would you prefer a wrong diagnosis to no diagnosis? That's really the issue.
But if that diagnosis leads them or the patient, like my husband, on a path of treatment, which is the same as Lyme disease, and getting successful results, doesn't matter what you call it, if the same method is achieving a positive result.
No, in that patient, no, it doesn't. Mm. The object is to get the patient better. So, but often patients are treated for undiagnosed illnesses by doctors and they get better anyway. And sometimes patients get better even without going to the doctor. You know, the medicine, that if you take it, you'll get better in 7 days, and if you don't take it, you'll get better in a week.
Jenny, you run the private lab in Australia that tested Chanel. You advertise Lyme testing. Why?
We started looking for the DNA of Borrelia in 2002. And if we hadn't found any, we probably would have stopped after maybe a year or so. However, we have continually been finding Borrelia.
Now, Borrelia is the bacteria associated with Lyme disease, right?
I don't like the term Lyme either. We're not American. And I think it's been a complete furphy and it should never have been used. It's a Borrelia infection.
But you're saying that you're finding...
Absolutely.
..the bacteria...
Yes.
..associated with Lyme disease...
Yes.
..in your laboratory.
Yes. Borrelia exists, and we are finding Borrelia burgdorferi, which is the type of Borrelia. We find other types as well, but we certainly have sequenced Borrelia burgdorferi repeatedly.
Is your lab accredited?
Not yet. And I must raise another point about that. There is no legal requirement for a laboratory, testing humans or otherwise, to have accreditation unless you're applying for Medicare.
Response, Stephen.
Yes, I'm sorry to have to say this, but I don't think that Jenny's correct. I think there's something happening in her laboratory that's resulting in her getting what we call false positive reactions. I don't think that there is Borrelia burgdorferi in Australia. I don't know of any other laboratory that's getting positives for Borrelia burgdorferi DNA.
Jesse, why did you choose an American lab to get tested?
Because I'd heard that the testing in Australia wasn't as strong as the testing overseas, that the laboratories in Australia weren't as good as the ones that were already dealing with these same vectors. I think that we need a rapid test.
Stephen?
Yes, well, I can't disagree that we need a better testing. There's no question about that, but it just can't happen with a drop of a hat. There has to be money made available to do it, and that's one of the biggest weaknesses. We don't have enough money to do it. So, yes, you're right, and I understand why you felt the need to send to another laboratory, but you probably got the wrong result from that American laboratory.
I don't think I did.
It's up to you.
But do you think it could be something other than Lyme?
I don't know, but... I do know that, you know, the antibiotics have helped, and they've helped drastically. Like, when I would stop taking the antibiotics, because I obviously don't want to be on antibiotics for the rest of my life, but every time I stop taking the antibiotics, the symptoms just, like, revert straight back to where they were. Even the rash on my feet comes back. And it's the Lyme rash. I mean, it's the rash that everybody...
I think we've got a picture of your rash here.
Yeah. So that's one. And there's another one. You can see the ring on my foot there. So it's...
So that's the what's called the bullseye rash, I think, that's associated with Lyme disease. Is that right?
Many rashes look like that. It's not specific to erythema chronicum. Can I ask you how long you've been taking your antibiotics for?
I've been taking them for about 9 to 12 months now.
How many antibiotics are you taking?
Three different varieties.
OK. How long was Chanel on antibiotics for?
She was on them for just over 2 years.
This was a doctor prescribing antibiotics for 2 years?
Yeah.
Yep. And
which
did they work?
We did see an immediate progress in her treatment, but unfortunately Chanel's situation was a bit different in the fact that her body wasn't absorbing them, so after time she just plateaued and things just sort of didn't get much better. So then that's when they do the IVs. They put the...
Intravenous antibiotics.
Yes, intravenous antibiotics into the bloodstream, which has a different effect, I imagine.
Did you have intravenous antibiotics?
No, I didn't, no. Mm.
And, Sam, you did?
Yeah, I did 2 weeks of oral. One, they were still waiting for test results, and then as soon as they came back and he put all the bits together, then I went on 4 weeks of IV and another 2 weeks of oral afterwards.
So that's more the standard treatment for Lyme disease overseas.
I'm not talking about Sam's treatment, but... These very prolonged therapy with multiple antibiotics, firstly, as Stephen's already mentioned, there have been a number of trials to show that that actually doesn't change the outcome of the patient. The second thing is they are potentially very toxic, and there have been deaths associated with unrequired intravenous therapy.
Yep, Stephen.
And the other issue that everyone needs to be aware of is the rising antibiotic resistance of bacteria. If people are taking antibiotics for such a long time, their bacteria are going to become resistant to those antibiotics after a relatively short time.
Kate, you say that Chanel was taking up to 200 pills a week?
Yep. Yep.
So how did you get her to take that many pills?
In the beginning, it was very difficult, and she would vomit a lot of them back up again. But over the time, she just became used to it and it started to make her feel a bit better, so she knew that.
Jessie, you're currently taking a high dose of oral antibiotics still?
Yeah, look, I'm still taking it.
Do you worry about taking them for that long?
Yeah, I do. I think it's... I mean, it's obviously got to cause damage, it's got to cause toxicity, but, I mean, what alternative do I have? If you give me an alternative, I'm happy to take it.
Miles, I mean, what do you say to Jessie, who says, give me a better option?
I think you have to be honest with patients. The first principle of medicine is non-maleficence. That means first do no harm. So don't give people false hope. Don't propose unapproved therapy which are potentially toxic. You've got to be honest and say, I acknowledge your illness. I don't know what it is. Nobody knows what it is at the moment. The symptoms that you have some similarities between a number of other syndromes we have, chronic fatigue syndrome, fibromyalgia. We know there are some treatments which help with the symptoms with those, so I would proceed to treat them along those lines.
Kate, earlier this year you took Chanel to Malaysia twice for what's called hypothermia treatment and blood ozone treatment. What does that involve?
Yeah, all right. So basically the machine heats the body up to a very high temperature. That's the only thing that can kill the bacteria that's in their system.
How high a temperature does it heat?
42 degrees.
Wow. The body. Who recommended this treatment?
It's recommended by a lot of people who have already been there and done it and have found to have some amazing effects and successful treatments and have gone back to their normal selves again after the body is killed of the bacteria, and it also is in combination with IV antibiotics at the time for about
a week
afterwards.
What convinced you to do it? What made you?
We're at the end of our line really with Chanel. She was fading away. She wasn't eating. She was probably on death's door. So I had to do something aggressive, and we organised a local fundraiser to raise some funds to go over to Malaysia for two treatments.
What was it like for you, Chanel, that treatment?
Well, the first time afterwards, it was horrible. I started getting the symptoms back pretty aggressively, and I spent a week there with nutrients, and a couple of weeks later, I was starting to feel better. And then the second one, which was that one, I felt better straight away. And
how much did that treatment cost?
The treatment cost $5,000. Well, actually, no, it was $4,000 for the actual treatment, but we incorporated some blood ozone treatment as well while we're over there.
And what's blood ozone treatment?
It's a purification of the blood, diseased blood. So they take, it's like a dialysis. They take blood out, purify it. There's probably scientific words to describe it, and basically put it back into the body.
Miles, what do you think of this sort of treatment?
Unproven experimental therapy needs further study.
Meanwhile, people are dying.
Agreed.
What else do you do with a sick child? And look at her now. She turned around 360 degrees after having the second treatment. She was, yeah. I mean,
the reason why we
I'd
do,
recommend it to anyone.
The reason why we do controlled clinical trials with a placebo arm is that many people get better no matter what you do. We can't prove that her intervention actually resulted in the outcome.
I can.
And you can only prove that by scientific study in a proper manner.
She's sitting here right next to me, and she's as healthy as she was before she was, before she got this disease. That's my evidence, and that's all I need.
This is what this argument gets down to over and over again, isn't it? It's the idea that, you know, people's experience is one thing and the science is something, you know, that everybody is debating and discussing, but people are saying, well, this is my individual experience. I mean, what do we end up relying on? Individual experience, or do we rely on science?
I think the audience also needs to appreciate that the doctors are also constrained. If I prescribe an unapproved therapy to somebody and they have a fatal reaction to that, the licensing authorities will firstly pull my licence. Secondly, my insurance company will say, well, your policy is null and void because you've not followed recognised therapy. So, you know, we also have limitations on what we can offer patients, because mainstream medicine has to use approved therapies, proven therapies. I mean, we'd all like to have a little chemistry workshop in the back and create magic cures, but we are constrained by the licensing authorities as well.
Kate, did you think about the risk associated with what you did?
But I knew what the alternative was.
And what did you think the alternative was?
She wouldn't have been with us for much longer.
What, you thought she was going to die?
Of course she was.
Why did you think she was going to die?
She wasn't eating. She was fading away to nothing. She was bedridden. The child hasn't been well enough to go to school for over 3 years.
Did you think you were going to die, Chanel?
For me, the mental side of it, the depression, I probably would have, but I would have done it myself.
What we need is action, and we don't have action. All we've got is words of people saying, you know, we're doing tests and studies and this. I mean, the people that are sick need the action. They don't need the words.
But first we must do no harm.
Excellent. Great.
Giving you
So if I die on your watch, is that doing no harm?
But can you also understand why, you know, doctors are saying that they want to have enough evidence to be sure that what they are doing is no harm?
Absolutely. I'm the first person to say we need a rapid test that we can, you know, give you at a GP's office and say, yes, you have this. No, you don't have this.
Well, there just has to be more resources put into it. It's as simple as that, because there are laboratories around Australia that will do that and can do that, but they haven't got the financial resources to do it. It's as simple as that.
OK. Sam, we've got some footage here. I didn't just want to show you collapsing playing tennis. We've got some footage here of you winning the US Open in 2011, which I'm sure you'll love to see. It's a good one. This was about 4 years after your Lyme diagnosis.
Sam Doza has won the US Open. And she has beaten Serena Williams. Yeah.
So that was 4 years later. How long did it take for you to get to a point where you were actually feeling more like yourself again?
A good few months, and then I was in the States doing all my treatment. So eventually when the doctors told me it was okay for me to come home, I came home and started really slowly with my training again, which was about a 20-minute walk. So it was about 10 months from when I first really noticed something to then when I was back competing again.
What's it like for you hearing this discussion about whether or not Lyme disease exists in Australia or a Lyme-like illness and about some of the treatments people are having that aren't the standard treatment that you had?
I think I'm very lucky. I think I'm very lucky that I ended up going back to America. Whether or not, you know, they obviously acknowledge that there is Lyme here, but you contracted overseas, so that would have been my scenario, but I just feel like everything is a little bit more progressive away from Australia as far as that goes.
How are you now?
I'm great.
Do most people make a full recovery from Lyme disease if they have it overseas?
Yes, the overwhelming majority.
Because this debate about Lyme disease is so prevalent around the question of ticks, is there a danger that other serious illnesses might be being overlooked?
I mean, the answer is yes, there's a danger.
Little is actually known about what Australian ticks have inside them in regards to their pathogen potential. So we're going out into the bush to find ticks to see if we can identify potential pathogens that could be in these ticks.
Well, let's spray ourselves first so we don't actually get bitten by any ticks.
So when we go out looking for ticks, we're looking for them along dirt tracks and paths.
Okay, let's check them.
So we can often use a flag, a piece of cloth that we can put across the vegetation, and that way we can also find the ticks.
So Alex, I've actually found a male as well. So we've got...
Here we go.
The nymph, a female and a male.
So when we're out in the bush and we come across a tick that we want to collect, then we put it into a tube of 70% ethanol and that kills the tick, and then we bring it back to the lab so we can identify it using morphological features of the tick. Then we need to actually break up the tick, and by doing that we actually freeze the tick so it's really cold, it becomes very brittle. We then add a ball bearing and then we pulverise it into a tick powder. So that powder contains tick, it also might contain blood from previous host and any potential pathogens. Then we go through a series of molecular techniques to amplify potential pathogens that could be in the tick. Ticks are known to cause illness in people all around the world, and I wouldn't be surprised if we do find something that could be causing Australians when they're bitten by ticks to become unwell.
Charlotte, what have you found so far, and how long do you think it'll be before you know more about what diseases ticks might be carrying?
We have found five new bacterial species that are unique to Australian ticks. At the moment, we don't know if they can be transmitted by ticks, let alone whether they can cause disease. And in those five new species, we have found a species of Borrelia, which is distantly related to any other Borrelia that we've that is known. So we've talked about Borrelia tonight. We know Borrelia burgdorferiensis lato is the group that causes Lyme disease. There's also two other groups of Borrelia, and the Borrelia that we identified, that was found in echidna ticks. So it's potentially a fourth group, so it's actually quite groundbreaking, fascinating research and findings that we're actually got a Borrelia that's actually unique to Australia.
So does that mean that we could have a Lyme-like illness in Australia, potentially, well, because you found that Borrelia, those different types of Borrelia?
Well, Lyme disease is associated with a specific group of Borrelia. And we don't know if this Borrelia can be transmitted by ticks that actually bite humans. We've found other bacteria in ticks that have been removed from humans. So at the moment, we don't know if it can be transmitted or if it can cause disease.
How much longer might it be before you know?
I guess, you know, it's about, as Stephen and Miles have talked about, it's about funding. It's about getting those funds so that we can actually do the research to help people like you. If you're bitten by ticks and you're unwell.
Defining what we're dealing with here is really important because it essentially, you know, has ramifications for treatment and all kinds of things. But one of the questions that I wanted to ask in summing up here is, with so much emphasis on whether or not Lyme exists in Australia, is there a danger too of overlooking other potential diseases that people might have, or that, you know, things that might be causing their symptoms, because some doctors are quick to jump to a Lyme-like illness as the explanation goal? Do you think there's a danger there?
I think it's happened. I mean, the answer is yes, there's a danger, but like what I was trying to say before is, let's stop talking about whether or not there's Lyme disease in Australia or not. Like, we can leave that to the guys who are looking in ticks to find what bugs we've got in ticks in Australia. What we need to do as health professionals is help the people that come and see us who say, I'm sick, can you help me? But we make sure that we use all of our skills and all of our experience to help the patient get better. That's the most important thing.
OK, we're going to have to leave it there. Thank you all so much for joining us tonight. Been really good to talk to all of you. And that is all we have time for here, but I'm sure you're going to want to keep talking about this on Twitter and on Facebook. We'll be back next week. Stay tuned now for Dateline. Thanks, everyone.